other items I remember going to different miners, talk with them, or we go into town Saturdays to buy our food for the week or for the 2 weeks, whenever, whatever we money we had. Ended up in a speakeasy. It was still prohibition in those days. And the old miners, noticing my German accent, invariably would tell me about their experiences with the American Army in World War I. And of course, they all had German Luger to brag about and expected me to know anything about it. I was only, well, 8 years, 10 years during that war, so I didn't remember anything about the weapons, but I had to pretend to know about it, and the miners got a lot of fun talking to me about their experiences in Germany, which existed probably 2-3 months in the Rhineland, where they got drunk and started making love to a lot of German girls. That's about all. But it was a great life. I liked the desert. Then I mentioned the miner brought his wife out. Shortly thereafter, one of the Grubstakers came out with his wife. And while the two women were there, of course, we had parties. We always had a lot of homebrew beer. And the guests brought a bottle of moonshine. So there wasn't very much work done, but a lot of drinking. And I didn't think much of it, but the women were very friendly with me. And it looked like the old miner didn't like that very much. Came a day after we had partied around, taking the women down to get water and show them the desert and really get noisy. Everybody had too much to drink, and we had quite a bit of food. I was getting a little concerned about the miner, and I got hold of his 45 to keep him from shooting, because he was in the habit of shooting at little animals when he got drunk, and I didn't want him to shoot very much. Somehow I had an idea something was going to happen, so I took the gun away and hid it. Sure enough, around 10 o'clock, well, long after dark, we all had bedded down in our bunks. He started to curse me and started and more or less accused his wife of making love to me or vice versa. And he said, "I'm going to shoot the two of you." And of course the guests, they were very, very scared. Syme didn't know what to do next. I had the gun, and Syme took out the little 32 which he had to be sure that everything, well, nothing was serious would happen. And so there was a lot of talk and yelling, and well, eventually quieted down. And the next day I told him that I'm going to quit, I'm not going to take that kind of stuff. The guests, his name was Moore, Denny Moore. He planned on going back to Los Angeles that night, and I asked him if he would give me a ride from Barstow. He said sure. And of course Claude by that time had sobered up, and he was really sorry that I would leave. He really tried to hold me, but I had made up my mind. There was no future in gold mining the way we did it, and I couldn't see loafing very much longer. I had about 3 months of it. It was a nice time. I learned a little bit about hard rock mining, but anyway, I packed my little suitcase. It was a very small one, and Syme took me into Barstow. And I hung around Barstow down at the railroad station, and towards the evening the sheriff came around and told everybody, including me, to be out of town by 7 o'clock. I told him I was getting a ride with friends. He said, "Well, if I see you, you know what's going to happen." But the friends came, took me into Los Angeles, and I stayed with them for a few days. They were very, very nice to me. In fact, he even got me a job in a furniture factory in Los Angeles. I found a place in a YMCA out on Video Boulevard in Los Angeles, and then I started working in the furniture factory. I was supposed to get 45 cents an hour. That was the hourly rate. But in the furniture factory, you also worked piecemeal, piecework. And I never managed to make 45 cents an hour. If I averaged 25 cents, I did well. Some of the others worked faster, knew more about it, and did a little better, but very, very few made 45 cents an hour. It was a bad time in Los Angeles. I tried prospecting once more with another German who worked in that factory. They went out into San Gabriel Canyon and looked around. Many people were camping out there, washing gold, making a bare existence. But of course I was single, had no responsibilities, so it didn't matter to me. But we went back to town and I held that job for a few more months. In the meantime, Syme had also quit during the winter and came into Los Angeles and moved into the same YMCA where I was staying. And Olaf Carlson had come out from New York, so I had a few friends there. And of course I was the only one who had a job, so I more or less supported them. Anything of great interest? Well, I got to know Los Angeles. I went to Roosevelt Evening High School, learned a little Spanish and a little more English. Syme got a job without pay in a flying field, and I had a chance to do a little repair work on a plane, for supposedly the pay had to be taken out in flying lessons, which never did me any good. I made many friends in that YMCA, who then later on helped me to get my citizenship papers. Along February or so, things were really poor in Los Angeles. I decided I had enough. I had an old Model T and just enough money to keep me going for a little while, so Carlson and I decided to go to San Francisco. Or we had even tried to get on a boat and didn't succeed. So we went to San Francisco. It took us 4 overnights, but we made it. And in San Francisco, I still had enough money to rent a room in a rooming house up on Post Street. And then, of course, we had to start looking for a job. Oh, San Francisco impressed me very favorably from the very beginning. On the way up, we had bought a sack, about 50 pounds of oranges. And I bought some sugar and I made orange marmalade. So we had orange marmalade and a lot of bread. Eggs were very cheap. I think they were about 20 cents a dozen or so. We managed to eat quite well and very cheaply. Jobs were hard to find. I went from bakery to bakery and from upholstery shop to upholstery shop. Finally, I got down to my last $25 or $30. I started going to an employment agency. It was an old German Schroeder. He was a real slave driver, nasty character. Everybody hated him, but he got me a job. And I started working in a fine bakery on Post Street, opposite the White House in downtown. It was a first-class bakery, and I worked there for quite a few months. Did quite well. It was a steady job. I think they paid only $20 a week, but out of that I could save quite a bit. And even though I had to start working in the morning at 4 o'clock, Saturdays we usually started at 1 o'clock, I still managed to go to night school and kept on going to night school, spent a lot of time in the library again. My time was spent in the library, museums, and Fisherman's Wharf. San Francisco is a great place for anyone, even if he's single, because you meet people and you can walk from one end of the city to the other, if you are a good walker. And of course the streetcars are there, the cable cars are there, So I liked San Francisco from the beginning. And, well, school, of course, you always meet people. That was interesting. I tried to move into the YMCA, but I couldn't afford it. That was a little too expensive. But one day I was sitting there, or it was down at a Embarcadero, when a character approached me and asked me if I want a job on a ship. I said, of course. He said, well, I can get you the paper. And he soon found out I didn't need anything, didn't know anything at all about shipping. So he told me what kind of a job he could get me when I told him that I am a baker. And he said, well, now I can get you the paper, the papers that you need, but they will cost you about $10. I said, I don't have that much. He said, well, I might be able to give them to you for $6. Meet me in the YMCA on the Embarcadero tonight. Well, that sounded good. I told Carlson about it. He warned me not to do anything like that. But I went there anyway, and the fellow was there, and he said, well, here are the papers, but I have to go up and get them signed from the fellow from whom I got it. So you have the $6? I gave him $6. He took the envelope with the papers. He had shown me the papers and went into the elevator, and that's the last I saw of him. I waited an hour, 2 hours. Of course, I didn't know the man's name. He may have gotten down the stairs and walked out of the building. So I lost $6 and no job. Well, I still had a job in the bakery. I kept on going to school and got acquainted with the teachers. I did pretty good work, probably, because one day one of the teachers told me, look, you are just a bobo going a little to sea, or I had gone to sea a little bit, one or two boats, and then you come back and go to school. Why don't you finish high school now, get your diploma, and go to university? You have nothing to lose. And so we talked a little bit, and that sounded interesting. But, well, I finished high school, and then I had my diploma. And then I saw in the paper that the University of California opened registration the very next day. Well, gee, I didn't know what to do about it, but I asked a neighbor where I happened to be living, and he told me how to go about. Well, anyway, I better keep on going back a little bit. In school I had met a girl, a Mexican girl, very nice and pleasant. She and her sisters and brothers operated a rooming house on Clay Street. And, well, sooner or later, I moved in. Carlson, he moved in with somebody else, I don't know what. So anyway, we just met weekends, and I moved into that Clay rooming house on Clay, and kept on going to school. Next to the rooming house was the owner of that house, and her son had gone to the University of California. So when the time came for registration, I woke him up early in the morning to ask him what to do about registration, how to go about doing that. In other words, I was that ignorant about the whole situation. Well, he said, go on over and show them the diploma, and they will give you a form to fill up. So that's what I did. And I stood in line with all the others, went up to the window. It was in California Hall in those days, small building. Showed them. She looked at me. She looked at me and the diploma. And then she went to another lady over there, and they discussed it, looked at me again. Of course, my accent displayed immediately that I didn't know what I was doing. So they told me that the diploma alone doesn't get me in. I have to get a record of my grades. Well, okay, went back to San Francisco. By that time I had given up my job, and they wouldn't give it back to me. I went to high school and asked them for the grades. They kind of laughed too, the way I went about, but within a matter of a few days, I had the transcript. So, but anyway, now that was 1934 now. I went back and signed up and actually registered. And then I saw the faculty advisor. And when he saw my transcript from high school, he noticed that for engineering I didn't have.